Please subscribe Pentacore channel and press the bell icon for all notifications and video updates.
Some marker substances that are used to measure the fluid compartment. Okay. Some markers. Okay. See, if we want to measure the total body water, then deuterium oxide or D2O or tritium oxide or T2O. This means it have a hydrogen with two valency. Okay, normally hydrogen have one valency, but it have a two positive charge and it have a three positive charge. And antipyrine. So these markers are used for to measure total body water. Now extracellular fluid. To measure extracellular fluid, either radioactive sodium is used, or chloride. All are radioactive. Radioactive sodium, chloride, bromide, okay, sulfate and thiosulfate. Now these were the radioactive. Now non-metabolizable saccharides that like, for example, insulin. It is also used. Mannitol, raffinose and sucrose. Now if you have to measure the plasma, amount of plasma, then either radioactive iodine is used, that is I-131, okay, or either Evans blue is used, okay, that is T-1824. So these were some markers that are used. Now guys, if you have to measure the total body water measurement, then how it is measured? Measurement of total body water. See, we have to use a fluid or something or a marker that should be distributed all over the body. Okay, so we use deuterium oxide, as told you earlier, or tritium oxide. Okay, for this, actually we mix it with all the fluids in all the compartment. When we inject it, they get mixed up with all the fluids in just few hours. Okay, and since we know that plasma is a part of total body fluid, so we take the concentration, we collect this plasma and then check the concentration of the marker substances in that plasma. Okay, so and then we put the concentration and each and everything into the formula, and then we get total body water measurement. Now if you have to measure the extracellular fluid, okay, measurement of extracellular fluid. See, we have to use a substance that pass through a capillary membrane. Okay, they pass through capillary membrane but they don't enter the cell, because if they enter the cell, it will not be exactly extracellular fluid. They will the concentration will be lower because slight amount of marker will be shifted into intercellular fluid. Okay, so they doesn't get entered into the cell. So we use radioactive iodine either so that it doesn't enter the cell. Okay, these substances, they remain only into the ECF. Okay. And when they are injected into the blood, around within 30 minutes to 1 hour, they mix up with all the extracellular fluid. And then we collect the plasma and then see the concentration and apply all things in the formula. Now see, let's take an example. It will be more clear to you. Now see, if we have to see the concentration of, if we have to measure the ECF. Now let's see, we have injected sucrose in a patient with a mass of about 150 milligram. Okay. See, I have earlier told you in a formula, in the first video you can see, in the earlier part, that there is a loss of certain amount of marker in the urine. So we cancel it out. Let's say urine excretion was about 10 mg. Urine excretion of sucrose is about 10 mg. And the concentration of sucrose we used was, 0.01 mg per milliliter. Now, on calculating in a formula, let's put these all values in a formula, that is V is equal to M upon C, that is volume. Okay, volume is equals to mass upon concentration, but we have to change the formula, that volume is equals to mass minus amount of urine loss upon the concentration. Now let's put 150 minus 10 mg upon 0.01. okay, now it is 140 upon 0.01. now 14000, because we have to make this decimal away, we have to multiply it by 100 upon 100, then it will be this ml. This value will be in ml because we have taken all in lower units. So it will be around 14 liter of plasma or extracellular. It will be around 14 liter of extracellular fluid. Now let's measure. How do you measure the plasma volume? Measurement of plasma volume. Okay. Now see, the substance which bind with the plasma protein strongly. We have to use a substance which bind with plasma protein strongly. Okay, and diffuse it into the interstitium only in small quantities. Okay, the main thing is here, and it does not diffuse anywhere other. Okay, so we have to measure the interstitial fluid. Now, measurement of the plasma and the interstitial fluid is somewhere same. See guys, I'm not showing explaining this in detail because we will be seeing this in another video of the blood volume, okay, where we will be measuring plasma and the volume of blood. Okay, so just remember, we have to use a substance which binds with plasma protein strongly. Now measurement of interstitial fluid, interstitial fluid volume. Okay, so it cannot be measured directly, so it is calculated that we know that ECF we know that ECF contains plasma and interstitial fluid. Okay, so we will subtract volume of plasma from interstitial fluid, then we will get interstitial fluid volume. So interstitial fluid volume is equals to extracellular fluid minus plasma volume. Okay, so this formula is used for the measurement of interstitial fluid. Now measurement of intracellular fluid volume. Okay, so it also cannot be measured directly. It is calculated. See, if we minus extracellular fluid from total volume of the fluid into the body, then we will get intracellular fluid. So intracellular fluid volume is equals to total fluid volume minus extracellular fluid volume. So this was all about the measuring the fluids or the volume of the fluids inside the body. Let's see the concentration of the body fluids. Now let's see how concentration of the body fluids are measured. Concentration of body fluids. Okay, these are measured or these are expressed in three quantities. The name of the first quantities are osmolality, second is osmolarity, and the third one is tonicity. Now let's talk about osmolality. Osmolality. See, we measure the capability of the fluid to create an osmotic pressure. Okay, and measuring this is osmolality. So we measure fluid capability to create osmotic pressure. Okay, measurement of this property of a fluid is called osmolality or osmotic concentration. Okay, see, in simple word I am telling you, this was a technical language. See, the concentration of osmotically active substance in the solution. Okay, concentration of osmotically active substance. Okay, this is osmolality, and it is expressed as number of particles or osmoles per kg of solution. Okay, means in short form, osmoles per kg H2O. It is expressed in this. Now let's talk about osmolarity. See, osmolarity is another term that is used to express osmotic concentration. It is number of particles or osmoles per liter of solution. It is easier per liter of solution. It is easier to understand than osmolality. Number of particles per liter of solution. It is like molarity, and this is like molality. Okay, that is osmoles per liter. See, osmotic pressure in solution depends on many things. Okay, depends on osmolality. But practically or in practice, osmolality and osmolarity doesn't have a big difference. Okay, as per the values. So we take them in exchange of each other. So in our daily practice, osmolarity is used more to find the concentration than osmolality. just because of the reason that measurement of weight of water in solution is a difficult process. Okay, why we take osmolarity? See, osmolarity is used more than osmolality. Why? Because measurement of weight of water, okay, water in solution is difficult. Okay, why it is easier to measure the amount of water or the quantity or the volume of water in liquid than in kgs. Okay, and the second thing that practically there is only difference between values of osmolarity and osmolality is about 1%. Okay, only 1% difference. So that's why more often they are used for each other. Now let's talk about tonicity. See guys, usually the movement of water or the fluid or any liquid part, it is not controllable by the small molecules. Okay, the larger molecules control that how the liquid will move into the cell or outside the cell or around the different compartments. So small molecules like urea, alcohol, they doesn't control, okay, that what amount of water or fluid will cross the cell membrane. So they are called ineffective osmoses. These small molecules are called ineffective osmoses. On the opposite hand, the larger molecules like sodium, glucose, okay, sodium and glucose, they are mainly responsible for the water to cross the compartment, okay, and they influence the movement of water. Therefore, what we do, first of all, these are called effective molecules or effective osmoses, and ineffective are the smaller ones. Now let's talk about osmolality again or osmolarity. So the osmolality or osmolarity of the water, okay, of the water that causes movement of the water from one compartment on or the another compartment because of or due to these large or effective osmol molecules is called see, what is tonicity? Let's talk about tonicity exactly. See, tonicity, it is the measure of effective osmolality in terms of tonicity. Okay, in terms of tonicity, the solutions are classified into three categories. Number one is isotonic fluid, second is hypertonic fluid, and the third one is hypotonic fluid. Okay, see, what we measure exactly, we only measure effective osmolarity. That I was trying to make you understand. And what is effective osmolality? See, we have to know what are effective osmoses. What is osmoses? Molecules that are responsible for movement of water, and that is measured in osmolality. Okay, now there are two types of molecules. One which are smaller in size, they are ineffective osmoses because they are not responsible for the movement of water. And on the other side, there are effective osmoses and they are bigger in size, bigger molecules like sodium and glucose, which are responsible for the movement of the water. So we find osmolality of that effective osmoses. Okay, so it is called effective osmolality. And to measure effective osmolality, it is called tonicity. And according to the tonicity, there are three types of solution: isotonic, hypotonic, and hypotonic. So let's talk about that. First is isotonic. So, see, if the fluid have the same osmolality or tonicity as the body fluids, okay, solution tonicity is same as body fluid tonicity, okay, then it is called isotonic fluid. For example, normal saline, that is 0.9% of NaCl or 5% of glucose, okay. See, if right blood cell, if we inject this isotonic fluid, then right RBC or red blood cell, okay, they neither gain nor lose water, okay, by osmosis. And this is also called osmotic equilibrium because there is no crossing of water from one membrane to another membrane. So RBC neither shrink nor swell. Now talking about hypertonic solution, hypertonic fluid or solution. So it have the greater effective osmolality than the body fluids. Body fluids have a smaller osmolality. Okay, means the solution have a greater osmolality or tonicity than body fluids. Okay. Now, it is called hypertonic fluid. Example will be 2% of NaCl. See, when it is injected to the blood, then RBC and the other cell in the blood, they will start to shrink and water will start to come out of these cell due to the process of exosmosis. Okay, so they will shrink. Now, the third one is hypotonic fluid. Now, its concentration or the tonicity of body fluid. Tonicity of body fluid is larger than the solution tonicity. Okay. For example, we can say 0.3% of sodium chloride. Okay. So if this solution is injected to the blood, then RBC and other cell will swell up because the water will move from the plasma to the RBC and due to the process of endosmosis. Okay. And now I will explain on a diagram. See, this is normal RBC. It is biconcave in shape. Okay. It is biconcave means this and this. On side view it is like this. This is the shape of RBC. Okay. When it is kept in isotonic, it remains same. Okay. It remains same biconcave. Okay. No change. If it is kept in hypotonic, then they will swell up. And by side you can see this will be the shape. Okay. And by front they will swell up. And if kept in hypertonic, they will shrink. Means this will be the shape. They will become like this. Okay. So this was all about solutions. Now let's see the applied physiology in the small part. Applied physio. Okay, we will be not going in detail because this will be explained in the pathology lectures. The first one is dehydration, and the second one is overhydration. And you can see all this in the pathology lectures. Thank you. Please subscribe Pentacore channel for more videos. It will help me. Thanks a lot.